Good morning and welcome. Welcome to Immanuel Lutheran Church on this fifth Sunday after Epiphany as we reflect on our God who comes to us exactly where we are, even in the midst of our suffering and our longings, and raises us up to be in health and wholeness and in service to one another. A special welcome to any guests that we have with us this morning. Our conviction that God makes us all unique and valuable means that we welcome you. We welcome you to bring your whole self with your own perspectives, abilities, ethnicity, gender identity, sexual orientation, and cultural background to this community where all belong and have a purpose. At Immanuel Lutheran Church, we are a community through whom God is transforming lives by sharing our faith in God's love and grace. At this time, I invite you into a moment of silence as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light, and our salvation. Amen. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, O living one, for you have created all and you water the earth abundantly. Oceans and aquifers praise you. Rivers and streams bless you. All life is sustained by you, our source. We praise you for Christ, the firstborn from the dead, who frees us from sin and raises us up to new life. Here, at this font, we touch the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing through the city of God. Here, death is washed away forever. Here, we are gathered into the tree of life with healing for the whole world. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, into the community around us, and throughout all creation. Cleanse us from our fears and drown our divisions. Grant that all may drink of your mercy and your peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you.
Shall I?
Let us pray. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. A reading from the 40th chapter of Isaiah. Did you not know? Have you not heard? Was it not told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood since the earth was founded? Yahweh sits above the vaulted roof of the world, and its inhabitants look like grasshoppers. God stretches out the skies like a curtain and spreads them out like a tent for mortals to live under. God reduces the privileged to nothing and throws the rules of the earth into chaos. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown, no sooner do they take root on earth, than God blows on them and they wither, and a storm wind sweeps them away like chaff. To whom can you liken me? Who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes and ask yourself who made these stars, if not the one who drills them like an army, calling each by name? Because God is so great in strength, so mighty in power, not a single one is missing. How can you say, tribe of Leah and Rachel and Jacob, my destiny is hidden from Yahweh, my rights are ignored by God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? Yahweh is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. This God does not faint or grow weary, with a depth of understanding that is unsearchable. God gives strength to the weary and empowers the powerless. Young women may grow tired and weary. Young men may stumble and fall, but those who wait for Yahweh find a renewed power. They soar on eagle's wings. They run and don't get weary. They walk and never tire. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The Patchwork Quilt by Valerie Flurney and pictures by Jerry Pinkney. Tanya sat restlessly on her chair by the kitchen window. For several days she had had to stay in bed with a cold, but now Tanya's cold was almost gone. She was anxious to go outside and enjoy the fresh air and the arrival of spring. Mama, when can I go outside? Asked Tanya. Mama pulled the tray of biscuits from the oven and placed it on the counter. In time, she murmured, all in good time. Tanya gazed through the window and saw her two brothers, Ted and Jim, and Papa, building the new backyard fence. I'm gonna go talk to Grandma, she said. Grandma was sitting in her favorite spot, the big soft chair in front of the picture window. In her lap were scraps of materials of all textures and colors. Tanya recognized some of them. The plaid was from Papa's old work shirt. The red scraps were from the shirt Ted had worn that winter. What you gonna do with all that stuff? Tanya asked. Stuff? These ain't stuff. These little pieces are gonna make me a quilt, a patchwork quilt. Tanya tilted her head. I know what a quilt is, Grandma. There's one on your bed, but it's old and dirty and Mama can never get it clean. Grandma sighed. It ain't dirty, honey, it's worn, the way it's supposed to be. Grandma flexed her fingers to keep them from stiffening. She sucked in some air and said, my mother made me a quilt when I wasn't any older than you, but sometimes the old ways are forgotten. Tanya leaned against the chair and rested her head on her grandmother's shoulder. Just then, Mama walked in with two glasses of milk and some biscuits. Mama looked at the scraps of material that were scattered all over. Grandma, she said, I just cleaned this room and now it's a mess. It's not a mess, Mama, Tanya said through a mouthful of biscuit. It's a quilt. A quilt? You don't need these scraps. I can get you a quilt, Mama said. Grandma looked at her daughter and then turned to her grandchild. Yes, your mama can get you a quilt from any department store, but it won't be like my patchwork quilt, and it won't last long either. Mama looked at Grandma and then picked up Tanya's empty glass and went to make lunch. Grandma's eyes grew dark and distant. She turned away from Tanya and gazed out the window, absent-mindedly rubbing the pieces of material through her fingers. Grandma, I'll help you make the quilt, Tanya said. Thank you, honey. Let's start right now. We'll be finished in no time. Grandma held Tanya close and patted her head. It's gonna take quite a while to make this quilt. Not a couple of days or a week, not even a month. A good quilt, a masterpiece. Grandma's eyes shone at the thought. Why, I need more material, more gold and blue and some red and some green, and I'll need the time to do it right. It'll take me a year at least. A year? Shouted Tanya. Well, that's too long. I can't wait that long, Grandma. Grandma laughed. A year ain't that long, honey. Making this quilt is gonna be a joy. And now run along and let Grandma rest. Grandma turned her head toward the sunlight and closed her eyes. I'm gonna make a masterpiece, she murmured, clutching a scrap of cloth in her hand just before she fell asleep. We'll have to get you a new pair and use these old ones for rags, Mama said, as she hung the last piece of wash on the clothesline one August afternoon. Jim was miserable. His favorite blue corduroy pants had been held together with patches, and now they were beyond repair. Bring them here, Grandma said. Grandma took part of the pant leg and cut a few blue squares. Jim gave her a hug and watched her add his patches to the others. A quilt won't forget. It can tell your life story, she said. The arrival of autumn meant school and Halloween. This year, Tanya would be an African princess. She danced around in long, flowing robes Mama had made from several yards of colorful material. The old bracelets and earrings Tanya had found in the trunk in the attic jingled noisily as she moved. Grandma cut some squares out of the leftover scraps and added Tanya to the quilt too. Nobody had realized how big it had gotten or how beautiful. Reds and greens and blues and golds and light shades and dark blended in and throughout the quilt. It's beautiful, Papa said. He touched the gold patch, looked at Mama and remembered. Jim remembered too. There was his blue and the red from Ted's shirt. There was Tanya's Halloween costume, and there was Grandma. Even though her patch was old, it fit right in. This story reminds us that God is in the mess and the multiple squares and the patches of life, in the wounds and the suffering, the tears and the joy. And God stitches it together to make a beautiful patchwork quilt of life. That is the promise of our God in Christ. That, dear God, thank you for stitching a beautiful quilt out of the messiness and the patches of life. Help us to stitch these patches together, to be your hands and feet for the healing and hope of the world. In your name we pray. Ready, big finish. Amen. The Holy Gospel, according to Mark, the first chapter. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now, Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. Jesus came and took her by the hand and raised her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening, at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And they cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for Jesus. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of our Lord. Let us open with a word of prayer. Good and gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The whole town came out to see Jesus. It sounds like an exaggeration, and I would have thought it was so until witnessing the whole county come out and call and go onto the internet and crash websites and phone lines and fairgrounds to get vaccines from COVID-19. Now we see the truth of this. When a great healer comes into the community, they flock to him, and the whole town indeed comes out because everyone knows someone who is ailing and in need of healing from a sickness, or as they understood, from demons or evils that trapped them. It would have been so easy for Jesus to talk himself up. It would have been so easy for Jesus to be the one that would make demons and the evil one and all people around him, his disciples and villages, serve him and wait on him and do his ever beckoning. Instead, he tells the demons who know him, while everyone else is wondering who he is, he tells the demons to remain silent. Instead, he cures many of them and isn't quite able to cure all of them. He cures who he can. But he also knows that he's called to other villages. He also knows that he needs to go to a deserted place and rest for a while and connect with his God. Because once again, like his 40 nights in the wilderness, he might be tempted. He might be tempted to take this position and this authority upon himself and to claim his own righteousness without God. But that's not who Jesus is. Jesus is the one who is centered in God. And so he goes into the deserted place and he prays and he prays and he connects. He remembers who he is. He remembers whose he is. He is not there for his own glory. He is not there for his life to be perfect or to be in only the fancy places in the world, have the best banquets and the best feasts and the best companionship. He is there to be in the midst of the hurt and the suffering of the world. And that is what he does. That is what he does. In Capernaum, he goes to Simon's house. And at Simon's house, he meets Simon's mother-in-law, who is sick in bed with a fever. And instead of keeping his distance because she might spread something to him, and we can relate to that now, as we are forced to keep distance from one another, not knowing who might carry COVID. Instead of keeping his distance from her, he touches her. He touches her and he raises her up, using the same verb that is used for him when he is raised up in the resurrection, when the serpent is lifted up in the wilderness for the healing of the nations. She is raised to resurrected life, new life. And what does she do? She serves them. Let me tell you, when I read this, I think, well, of course she serves them, right? Isn't that what a woman was supposed to do back then? Talk about patriarchy. She can't even rest. It reminds me of someone that I know who would have migraines when she was raising her children. And when they would come home and she'd been in bed all day, still when they came home, she would get up and cook them dinner. Really? They couldn't figure out how to cook dinner themselves? Goodness gracious. I always struggled with this part of the scripture that said that she served them. Did Jesus expect it? Is that what he wanted? Did he just heal her so that she could serve him? Well, I kind of think maybe yes and maybe no. Setting patriarchy aside, setting roles aside, setting the lack of opportunities aside, which are very real problems, which are things that we need to celebrate today, that women have more opportunities and a variety of roles that they can be called to. Setting all that aside, we see that this woman had the vocation of hospitality, of service, and the verb to describe her service is not that she gave them a meal, that she hosted them, that she cooked to them with for them. It was the verb in Greek, diakonia, the verb we recognize from the word deacon or diaconal. This is a service and this is a holy calling. Indeed, when Jesus is in the wilderness, tempted by Satan, and finally turns him away, the angels come and they wait on him. They serve him. They diakonia him. Again, when Jesus later tells his disciples that the Son of Man was come not to be served, not to have the glory thrust upon him, but to serve, it was that he was called to diakonia, to be of service. And he tells them, this is the example for you. You are not called to lord it over others as others would tell you to do in society. You are called to diakonia, to service. And it is not just service to the fancy muckety mucks of the world, those in power. It is not in service so that you can be in charge or control or have full glory. It is in service to the least of these, to those who are suffering the most, to those who are hurting the most. You see, our God is a God who comes to us in the midst of the suffering. And this is the Lutheran theology of the cross. Instead of the seductive theology of glory that would tell us that when we turn to follow Christ, that everything good is going to be thrust on us, we will never suffer again, and we can have all wealth and goodness and don't have to worry about those out there. Instead, we have a theology of the cross that says that following Christ thrusts us into the suffering of the world, that in the midst of serving one another, we will continue to experience our own hardships. And so we continue to go to our deserted places or to our communities and connect with our God in whom we are centered, so that we can have, as Christ needed too, the connectedness with God, the fullness of the Spirit to give us the strength to put one foot in front of the other. Sometimes, beloved children of God, life is hard. Sometimes we suffer global pandemic. Sometimes our hearts are broken for those whom we've lost. Sometimes we are fearful or experiencing the sickness of body, mind, and spirit. And God is the one who raises us up. As Isaiah says to us in chapter 40, this is not a God who has now raised us up. This is a God who you have heard of, who you have heard of from ancient scriptures from the past that remind you that God has been with your ancestors and continues to be with you. Isaiah, who tells them in the midst of exile, away from their homeland, that this is the God who, when you are weary, will raise you up as strong as the eagle that is flying on the wind. God will raise you up so that you will not be faint, you will not be weary, and you can continue forward. But God does not raise us up for our own glory, to lord it over others, to exercise power over others, or power that would take and oppress other people. God raises us up and heals us just like Simon's mother-in-law in order for our Lutheran vocation of service, of diaconia, to be able to be fulfilled. She was restored to the calling that God had given her. And so are we. So, beloved child of God, how is God calling you into the suffering of the world? To fulfill through you, meet the needs that are out there. Maybe you are providing meals for the overflow shelter. Maybe you are working in advocacy and petitioning your political leaders to set policies that are just for people of all colors and creeds and persuasions and orientations and genders and all people. Maybe you are at the bedside of your mother or your sister or your neighbor trying to care for them. Maybe you are on your knees in prayer. How is God calling you not to turn from the suffering, but to enter into it and giving you the strength to do so? On this Black History Month, I confess that I am torn because I recognize that we need to do a better job of claiming the history of our nation that incorporates the stories of all voices, of all races. And yet, until we continue to work that direction, it is good that we have Black History Month. It can let it not be where we stop, but where we start to tell these stories. And so I want to lift up the story of a woman who is the perfect example. This is an everyday woman who is, to me, the perfect example of what it means to enter into the suffering of your own story, to have God lift us up on eagle's wings and empower us to serve, to find our vocation and our calling to serve the needs of the world. This is a story of Dr. Hadia Nicole Green. When she was just 4 years old, she had lost her mother and her grandparents. Hadia, Nicole, and her brothers went to live with her Auntie Ora Lee Smith and her Uncle Jen Lee in St. Louis, Missouri. In her early 20s, at just about 22 years old, her aunt and uncle were both diagnosed with cancer. Her aunt didn't want to go through chemo anymore. She wanted to see her youngest son get married, and she did. She wanted to see Hadia graduate from college from Alabama A&M University, and she did. And then she died, and her uncle also died. And this story compelled Hadia Nicole Green to go on to graduate school and med school and to work in oncology and to work toward cures for cancer. And indeed, she is a doctor who has successfully developed technology that has killed cancer cells in laboratory mice and has killed cancer without the use of chemotherapy and radiation that are so hard on the body, without observable side effects. Can you imagine? Her work is in the process of moving forward into human trials. This Dr. Green is an assistant professor at Morehouse School of Medicine, and she is the founder of Ora Lee Smith Cancer Research Foundation, which is named in honor of her late aunt, this woman who took her and raised her from the suffering that she experienced. The Spirit of God gave her strength to turn this suffering into a calling. God raised her up so that she could not turn away from the suffering of the world, but turn toward it and use her intellect and her compassion to serve the needs of those who are suffering from cancer. Beloved children of God, the theology of the cross is a gift because it's real. It's real. We have a God who promises us not that we are going to be glorified and we are going to have our own authority and we're going to have power over people. We have a God that says, I'm going to make your life have meaning because I'm going to raise you up to resurrected life, to life that can take this suffering and transform it into compassion and into service, to heal the suffering and the wounds of the world. And in that, we will have life and have it abundantly. In Christ, and the Spirit that fills us, all of this is possible. And so, may the peace and the love and the compassion and the healing of Christ, which surpasses all human understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in this same Christ Jesus, now and always. Amen.
God forgave my sin in Jesus' name. I was born again in Jesus' name, and in Jesus' name I come to you to share his love as he told me to. He said, freely, freely you have received, freely, freely give. Go in my name, and because you believe, others will know that I live. All power is given in Jesus. freely, freely give. Go in my name, and because you believe, others will know that I live.
Let us pray. Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For the church, for ministries of healing and wholeness, for hospital, hospice, and military chaplains, for those serving in prison ministry, for all who proclaim freedom and release in the name of Christ, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For creation, for insects in the grass, clouds on the mountaintops, for cattle and the rainwater they drink, for the humility to take our place among all creatures of the earth, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For the nations, for all who lead in cities and towns, states and countries, for community organizers, school officials and CEOs, for international health organizations, that in time of trial, fear, or hopelessness, they find freedom in service to those most in need. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God, for all wearied by life's burdens, for those who are poor, for those lacking supportive relationships, for those crushed by debt, for those struggling with chronic pain or sickness, for those exhausted from overwork or stress, and for all who cry out to you. We pray especially for those on our prayer list: Fran, Leela, Robbie, Mike, Jean, Leon, Perry, John, Debbie, John, Ken, Angela, Lori, Michael, Randy, Denny, Dorothy, Carpo, Bob, Jerry, Mallory. For what else do the people of God pray?
For all healthcare workers that are working tirelessly to distribute the COVID vaccine, O Lord, keep them safe and help us show our appreciation. For all nations throughout the world as they distribute these vaccines, for families and students and teachers that are trying to educate and teach our children, help them learn and stay safe. For all those who are working tirelessly to be first responders and to help people in various ways.
Be with those who are struggling emotionally and financially with the pandemic. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For this congregation, for outreach ministries such as the Satellite Overflow Shelter, for care team ministries, for our Immanuel Lutheran kids and families gathering safely. Let us pray. Have mercy, O God. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God our thanks and our praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of the star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the sign of water turned to wine, he revealed the fullness of your glory. Holy and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love, you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal those who are sick and suffering, who preached good news to those who are poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, Christ's life, death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share in this heavenly food, the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. We are bold this morning to pray that risky prayer that Christ first taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Beloved children of God, we recognize that ideally we would receive Holy Communion in community, and yet we also recognize that the Holy Spirit comes upon us and unites us as one body of Christ wherever we find ourselves. So if you feel comfortable, you are welcome to set your altar wherever you are today and to join us for communion. Receiving the bread of life, this is the body of Christ given for you. Receiving the cup of grace, this is the blood of Christ given for you. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Lift every voice and sing, till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as a listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith in the dark past just taught us. The hope and the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun, our new day has begun. Let us march on till victory is won. Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod, felt in the days when hope unborn has had died. Yet with thy steady beat, have not our weary feet come to the place for which our parents sighed. We have come over a way with the tears have been watered. We have come treading our path with the blood and the slaughter. Out from the gloomy past, till now we stand at last, where the white gleam of our bright star is cast. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who has brought us thus far on the way, thou who has by thy might led us into the light, keep us forever in the path, we pray. Lest our feet stray from the places, our God, where we met thee. Lest our hearts, drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadow beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land.
Beloved children of God, receive God's blessing. May God the Creator strengthen you, Jesus the Beloved fill you, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter keep you in peace now and forever. Amen. Go in peace. Be the light of Christ. Thanks be to God. A brief time of announcements. Thank you to all who contributed to worship today. Your gifts have been a blessing to all of us, and we give you thanks. Also, a special thank you to those who might be joining us for the first time. We invite you to find our information and to reach out to us so that we may reach out to you and get to know one another better and support one another during this time. We have fellowship time immediately following worship around 10:30 a.m. using our Zoom link. If you do not have the Zoom code for our online meetings, please contact myself or the office and we'd love to get that to you. Also tomorrow, Monday, is our 12:30 p.m. book study. For those who are in book study, and for those who want to join us, we are reading the book In the Days of Awe and Wonder by Marcus Borg. On Tuesday night, we have Bible study at 6:30 p.m. So we invite you to come and be a part of that. That is also online. And for those who are in the executive committee, please note that our meeting will be at 6 p.m. tomorrow on Monday online. And for the Transformation Renewal Team, our meeting is at 4:30 p.m. online. All those meetings require the same code. The week after this one is Ash Wednesday, and we will be delivering blessing bags to people and inviting you to come on Ash Wednesday if you've signed up for one of our parking lot blessings at either noon on Ash Wednesday, the 17th of February, or at 6:30 p.m. There will also be an online worship offered as well. But please let us know if you're coming to one of those parking lot services so that you can pick up your blessing bag there and so that we know how many to expect. This season of Lent coming up, we will be reflecting on everyday spirituality. So there will be a devotional book available to practice our faith in our daily life. It's the little things that we do to connect with God and to live God's grace in the world. And so blessings to you in the rest of your week, and may we go forth and serve. Amen.